punk band from London. The band released their first demo in 2013 with four of the most pissed off songs the UK had seen in a long time. The demo was released on Self-Acceptance Records in the UK and Fight On All Records in the US. The band's core members stayed fairly consistent throughout the years, with Niall on vocals, Alex on drums, and Scott on guitar. The band briefly had a second guitarist called Nando, and they started out originally with Ed Milo on bass. The band had a few bassists throughout the years, including Louie Hardy from Higher Power, Big Cheese and Great Reality, but for the last while the band had their friend Benjamin Wolf on bass. Niall now plays bass in Payday, Ben now plays in Lawful Killing and has previously played in Frame of Mind, Guidance and Payday, Scott also played in Frame of Mind, and Alex currently plays for Big Cheese and Higher Power. Niall has been a staple of the UK scene, continually travelling the UK for shows and originally putting on shows of his hometown of Milton Keynes. Personally, I've always enjoyed the band for how honest and pissed off it is, as well as Niall between sets speaking his mind and talking about the state of the police force, as well as many other topics we've most been approached, using his platform for the positive. The band played their last show on Saturday the 16th of March 2019 at New Cross Inn in London, and I spoke to Niall briefly before the set.
So, my older brother, he was like, we lived in America for like 5 years when I was younger for my dad's work, and my brother got into hardcore over there. He liked bands like Sick of It All and Cro-Mags and whatnot, but like also like the early like Warped Tour metalcore kind of stuff. Not like when it all went super like deathcore stuff, but like the earlier stuff. And then I didn't get into it then, but he introduced me to like heavier music, the bands like Slipknot. The first punk band I ever got into was The Clash. That's because my dad liked them as well, so that would be something that we'd listen to in the car and whatnot. But then, yeah, when we moved back, and then I didn't really listen to heavy music for that much. And then probably when I was about 12, 13, I got more into like kind of like the metalcore, but not like good metalcore, like the generic Criminal Horizon kind of stuff. So that was like my reintroduction to heavy music, and that'd be, I started going to gigs and stuff like that then. And then I lived near a town, city called Milton Keynes. And there's a venue called the Crawford Arms, which is in Wolverham. And I used to go to shows there. And then one day, there was like a fest. I can't remember what it was called now, but it was like a hardcore show. Because it was my local, I used to go there for all sorts of gigs. And I went on the day of the Bane played, Trapped Under Ice, Alpha Omega, Cold Snap, Broken Teeth played, This Is Colour played, I think. Like a bunch of like random hardcore bands, they played. I went to that, and like I was real, like when I seen it, everyone's moshing and shit, and it was like, you know, this is what I like, this is the kind of stuff that I like. And then I met people there, particularly I met a guy called Tintin, who's does a lot of artwork for UK hardcore bands and American bands and whatnot. And my friend, who we call Milky, I met them at that gig. And the only reason why I spoke to him is because Milky's name was actually Niall. It's like the fucking little like 13-year-old kid I was. I was like, oh, my name's Niall too. Started chatting to them, added them on Facebook and whatnot. And then, because of that, I started listening to TUI. I never listened to them before the gig. I never listened to any of the bands that played apart from a band called Broken George. Their singer ended up being a pedo, so fuck them, yeah. But that was the only band that I knew on the lineup. But then, so I started listening to TUI and Alpha Omega and whatnot. Still was into like the shitty metalcore, but kind of delved more into it. And then it got to a point where like there was all sorts of hardcore bands that I was into. And then, but I was about 14 at this time, and I didn't start really. I went. That was like my first show, and then I went. I think my second proper show was I think it was Terror and Backtrack, and I think Alpha Omega might have played as well, potentially. They played The Underworld, so that was like my second show. And at that point I was like super into hardcore and enjoyed bands, but I was still, because I was so young and I wasn't living in the city going to shows, I wasn't as consistent. And then yeah, after that I kind of just gradually started going to more shows, met more people, you know, listened to more bands, and yeah, it went from there. It kind of became a thing that I was not obsessed with, but very indulged in. It was a passion, like it is for most people. So yeah, that's where I kind of started out. So I met, so my friend Milky was part of the Straight Edge. And around the time, I used to get a lot of stick from people when I was younger, when I was only 14, you know. I wouldn't say that I was like a, I definitely tried too hard in trying to like make friends now, because I was very into everything that I was around, and it was like, for some people older than me, they might just annoying. But now when I look back on it, they were just dickheads, it was simple as that. And at that time, like the London Shredders, like Charlie, Nick, Jimmy, they all kind of like took me under their wing. And that became like my first like solid group of friends that I made through hardcore. And I was already straight at this point. I've been straight playing around the same time I got to hardcore, so around 14. But they kind of like fully showed me that what you, the kind of friends you can make through it, and the connection you have with these people. Not even just through hardcore, but the fact that you've got so much in common with them in the real world as well. Like, a lot of them like football as well. I love football. So it was like a proper solid group of mates. Not just people that I'd see every now and then at shows, people that I'd spend a lot of time with. So they definitely took me on their wing. Kind of like my old heads and my influences, and kind of brought me up through that. And they're still some of my best friends today. Like, I've known them now for like 8 years or something, so. I think those London Straighters lot with the people that I wanted to be a part of, because I loved the idea of having like a unified group of people based around Straighters. Not that that was the only thing that, because you know, like Tinson's not Straighters. Yeah. There are a few people that angry with us that weren't Straighters. And so for them, I definitely looked up to them. I think I got to a certain age where I was very comfortable with myself, where it was like I wasn't trying to be anyone else. I just felt very comfortable with the people, with the friends that I had, and the kind of place that I'd taken. So, you know, of course I looked up, like a band that I always loved to have heart. I was like, look up to those people purely because they, being a younger kid, you don't really kind of think that far into the future, but you look at these people that are a lot older than you and they're doing so much stuff, whether it be music or putting on gigs or anything like that. You kind of want to have that same effect. And then on the next level, so yeah, the London Shredders was definitely the bigger influence for me, and I was like that, on like a friend level. Yeah. The thing is with hardcore now, of course social media was a thing when I got into hardcore, but the kind of like the climax of it to compared to how it is now is very different. I think I still hear a lot of bands have a message, which I think is good. I don't think people should talk about stuff unless they really mean it. I think a lot of people say things on like a gimmicky level because they think that people want to hear it. And I get that. I don't think you need to have a message. I love watching bands that don't say a word. Like, that's more intense. For me, I speak about things that I've had personal experiences with. I've had personal negative experiences with the police. And I don't think that everyone should now take that opinion of mine and make it theirs. Just for the sake of it. A lot of people throw around fuck the police and ACAB just saying it. But I say it, and the things that I say, it comes from personal experience. I won't get up there and feed some bullshit to hope that people like it. I've gotten to a point now, especially because of how long Blind Authority has been a band. I've got songs that are political, and I've got songs about police, I've got songs about all sorts, but things get watered down very easily, and people can do that, because I've met people that will say a certain thing on stage but they don't really follow up with that and they don't believe it. A lot of people say stuff about the police, but then a lot of people will be the first people to threaten you with the police about little things, and I don't care if people like the police. It doesn't, I don't dislike people for that. Like I say, it's my personal opinion. I'd much rather bands now be very honest and truthful with what they have to say. I think if a band doesn't want to say anything like that, fine. Not every band has to have a message. I think with BA, lyrically, because of how the vocals are on recording, the lyrics don't always transfer that through much, so I would say certain things that I would want to say. But I don't think there necessarily needs to be a message in hardcore. I think the internet plays such a massive part in it. I think you can listen to a band's music and read their lyrics and get the message from that, and then that. You don't need to hear them say something on stage. But then there's certain bands with a certain impact. You know, bands like our Fury, obviously they're American, but even UK bands like Abolition, when they were a band, very political band, and I think at the time they needed to speak about what they spoke because not many people had done it. But I think now, you don't always have to have something to say. Just play big music, be in hardcore for the right reasons, and then that's fine. You shouldn't have to have something that you vocalise and carry with you to legitimise your band and what you're doing, because it's not really about that. In terms of when we've been on tour, of course, Slovakia, every time, played there 3 times now, fucking mental, like, fireworks, people setting themselves on fire, like, mental shit. In terms of England, I really enjoyed that Outbreak pre-show, on the most recent one, I really liked that one. When we played Boston Music Rooms once, 2015, just before we went on tour to America, and that was mental as well, that was a good show. We played a lot of good shows, thankfully, so it's like, it's hard to pick, but those are the ones that stick out when I think about it. When we started the band, we were all in really awful bands beforehand. And we kind of thought no one was going to give a fuck. So when we released the demo and we got the reception it did, we were obviously super hyped off that. So I think the thing that really was like the best moment was when Carried Away asked to put out our LP. Because there was a lot of delays with the 7-inch and it kind of, when it came out, it was delayed. It wasn't as impactful and didn't mean as much at that point. Because we fell out with the guy that done the label and everything. It was kind of like, no one really paid attention. But when Carried Away asked to do that LP, that was a big moment for us, because they offered that. Then we toured America. And that's something that we all dreamed of doing. Like, it was like, that was like a very surreal moment. That would be the highlight. Releasing that LP and then going to America within like the space of 6 months of that, because we literally dropped the LP, what got them sent to America for the first day of tour. So that combination was definitely the highlight here. I think now it's like it's picking up a lot again. Leeds obviously have a lot of good bands, and I think it's good because they're a hub for it up north. London is kind of like a hub for it down south, and you've got many different scenes within London, that's the thing. So you've got all the Ruction bands, legend bands like Knuckle Dust and Nine Bar, and some of the younger bands that are coming up. You've got the punkier bands, a lot of them that play like Static Shock and stuff like that. There's all sorts of like different scenes, so there's a lot of bands coming up. And I do think it's just because now, it's like a lot of young kids will come out, they'll see people doing bands and then they'll want to start bands. So there's a lot of younger kids that are coming up. Like our bass players, other band called Lawful Killing, the other guys in that band are all mad young, but like they're all like 16, 17. And that for me is cool, because the band that I started when I was that young, no one gave a fuck about. So I think it's good that younger kids can come out, start a band, and people be into it and it can kind of take that route. So I think London's always been a very creative city, whether it be for music or anything like that. So I think it's natural that it continues to produce bands. Every now and then there's a bit of a bold patch and it's not as consistent, but I think for as long as hardcore is thriving, then more and more bands will keep coming out. I think, yeah, because London's the capital, I think with how widespread the scene is, it just generates more kids that want to do it, and it kind of goes in like a cycle. Yeah. So. When I first got into hardcore, up until I was probably about 16, there was rarely any all UK band lineups. People, and if there was, no one would go. It was very much American band tour, those are the big shows. It wasn't as often, because not any, apart from bands like Terror, who obviously tour quite a lot, none of these other bands are coming over every other month. So the big difference now is that there could be an all UK lineup and the show sells out, and that people come out for those bands. So I think it's become a lot more based around the UK. American bands come over, but then American bands come over and the support is a solid UK lineup, and you only need one American band, you don't need a package deal to bring people out, and you get packed out shows. Like for I know tonight we've got an Italian band playing, but it's an all UK lineup, and it's packed. So it's like, that's the big difference for me, is that the UK kind of can stand on its own and not have to rely on other bands from other countries coming over to keep the scene going and to make shows happen. you'll constantly see all UK lovers. That's the big difference that I've noticed. And there's more people going to shows. There's a lot more people involved. That's like the big difference that I've noticed. I like this venue a lot, New Cross. I think up north, I've always, I mean, when Temple of Boom became a thing, I've always liked Temple of Boom. It's difficult, there's all sorts of venues, but I think in terms of London, this is probably like one of my favourite venues. Trying to think what else. I like Boston Music Rooms, but obviously that's very. Depends on the gig. You know, it's a big venue. I like that. And then up north, yeah, I'd say Temple of Boom. Like, yeah, Broomall was sick. Broomall was sick. I like Broomall a lot. But. Massive. Those guys have been going since before I was born. Bands like Nine Bar Knuckle does it. Nine Bar Knuckle does it especially. Without them, London Half would be nothing. I know you've got Discharge and all these other UK bands in the 80s and stuff that formed it, but Ruction, as that collective and the LBU collective, they've done so much for London hardcore and the impact they've had, whether or not people can see that, because obviously because they're a lot older, they've been playing all the time. But when they do play, it packs out. Because, and for me, it's like Nine Bar are probably my favourite UK hardcore band of the time. So the impact they've had is fucking massive, and it's like, and they're very humble about it as well. You know, they're very kind of like. And they care about new bands. Whenever they do their Russian gigs, they get newer bands on, they get younger bands on, they proper care for it. So what the amount of time and money they put into it is commendable. They've done their thing so much. Done so much. Without them, none of this would be happening. None of this would be happening. Definitely taught me a lot. It's taught me a lot about friendship. It's taught me a lot about morals. It's educated me in a lot of ways. I think now it's more of a hobby now instead of it being like a centerfold, because it's more like now, as I'm getting older. I mean, I'm only 22, but as we're getting older, there's real life is takes over. So there's a lot of, you know, a lot has changed, but I still love hardcore. But the impact it's had on my youth, you know, giving me this band, touring, all of that, the friends that I've made, it'll impact my life forever. It's given me memories that I'll hold to my heart forever. So, yeah, it's done a lot now. I consider it more of a hobby now because I can't go to every show like I could. It's different now, but yes, it's impacted my life a lot, in a lot of ways.
What are you doing at St. Hardcore? Are you doing a lot of photography and shit? Have you just finished uni as well?
Yeah, so I just graduated from university. I studied photography there. I do all sorts. I go to football a lot. I like to travel when I can if I've got the money. Still do my photography. I like boxing. I like going to the gym. Just kind of standard stuff. I go to shows when I can. And I just try and keep busy. I'm looking for work at the moment, trying to move back to London. But yeah, like music and football and all that, that's like my main, my big passion. For I think we've taken on like our on that forefront of London Straight. But I think now it's like everyone is pretty much based up north, apart from me and yeah, just me. Marco's from London, but like Pimmy, our drummer, is from Liverpool. Jack's from Liverpool, so it's a northern band kind of now. But we'll always continue carrying London Straight purely because me and Marco have been part of that collective since we were young. So we still forefront that now. So I do understand why people say we're kind of average, because there's not really many straight bands in London. So I'll carry that name forever. I'm never going to let that go. No matter how much people want me to, I'm never letting that go. I've been to so many now where it's hard to pinpoint a single one. The Cro-Mag set at Outbreak, not the last one, the one before, I loved that. In terms of UK bands, Higher Powers release show for that LP like 2 summers ago, I think. Shit, there's honestly Big Cheese release show. There's honestly so many, and that shows how good UK hardcore is. I'm not trying to too much, but I've been to a lot of shows. There's been a lot of shit shows that I've been to, but and then there's been so many good ones, it's so hard to pinpoint. It's very difficult for me to pinpoint. I love the Outbreak pre-show. When Breakdown done that little small set. Honestly, there's so many to pinpoint. But yeah, anytime I see the Flex, anytime Violent Reaction Last Show, Abolition Last Show, yeah, those are definitely some of them. Yeah, for sure. When Boston Strangler toured, Shrapnel Last Show. Let's honestly see this song. Big Cheese, Frame of Mind, Higher Power is still doing big things. There's a newer bass. I'll shout out Stage of Faith as well, actually, because they're doing something very different. Not necessarily hardcore, but all hardcore kids, they all give a fuck. Arms Race is still smashing it. They've been around for a while, but they're still smashing it. There's so many, like Lawful Killing and Sick. There's loads of little bands that are coming up and doing stuff. And there's bands that, you've got bands like Splitting Up that are doing a lot. You know, there's such a wide contrast of bands now that it's not a worry when certain bands drop off, because there's other people that will carry on, there's people that will continue to play bands and make music. So yeah, there's a lot going on, a lot of good hardcore bands. Bands like High Viz, not necessarily hardcore band, but hardcore people doing it, Singer of Dirty Money. Honestly, there's loads, there's so many. Yeah, I've not been this nervous for a gig in a while. I'm happy. I'm obviously a little bit sad. It's pretty much my youth. But now I'm excited. So all my family here, my friends are here. Like, it's everything that I could have asked for. So yeah. Yeah, my parents, my brother, my sister, Scott's mum and dad, Ben's dad, all sorts. I'm excited. I'm excited, but I'm excited. Of course.
Thank you.
No worries, man.